Benna. 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 Bønner. 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 Bønner.
Thank you.
ein Risiko. Das Risiko ist unbekannt. Es wartet hinter jeder Wand.
Anymore, or the new Cold War could turn into a hot war and we could finally have World War III, which we were always expecting in the 1970s and 80s, but now it looks like it's almost here.
And of course, there are other scenarios which are not as well covered, not even in Extrabladet, like the solar flare, polar shift, or zombie apocalypse.
We call these catastrophes without events, because they're happening all the time. We read about them, we hear about them, we discuss them, but it never seems to reach us somehow. Here, everything just keeps on going.
But now, something has happened. Out there, total disintegration and chaos. You made it in here. We're happy about that. But of course, this can't last forever.
Yeah, you're safe for the moment, but out there, hell is breaking loose. And you have to prepare for an event like that. I hope you are all prepared. Let's do a quick check here. You got a lot of luggage with you. Can you tell us what's in this bag? Computer and coffee machine. Well, sorry, both of these won't work anymore because there won't be any electricity. Anything else? Anything a little more useful? Tupperware containers. Is there food in them or are they empty? Empty, but that's good to have. I mean, you might find some food and then you can carry it with you and it won't turn bad that easily. So the Tupperware containers give you a few hours. The other stuff is useless. So I will give you an initial survival time of, let's say, 6 to 8 hours.
Look at this. To start with, this is a cotton bag. Can as well be used to bandage in case you injure yourself.
You can make some emergency clothing.
Papers, rather without any value. There's some medication
that's good.
Can be bartered. Not very much if you really are in use or need of it, then this is something you should be careful about, not use it all at a time. Some handkerchiefs.
Those are good. They can also be used for emergency blood stilling and other medical uses. They're pretty clean. You might not get infected that quickly.
And a pair of extra glasses. Initial survival time, if you slow down on that beer and keep some, I'd say 2 to 3 hours.
There's other people in the world who are better prepared than these two examples we just saw. The president of the United States, for example, has an extra airplane. Not the FS1 that we all see on the news. There's another one that's very similar but better because it has complete command infrastructure on board. So in case of crisis, last happened after 9/11, the US president just gets on board, he takes off and he's gone. Because this airplane, like military airplanes, can be refueled in the air. So the US president or the emergency government aboard that plane can stay up in the air as long as down here everything's in turmoil for almost indefinite time. And nobody knows where they are, so the enemies can't attack them. That's what we call the bug out strategy. Get out of here, go to a safe place, and over the clouds is probably going to be pretty safe, unless it's the solar flare. A similar strategy is used by the very rich people. Like you've all heard about the super yachts of the Russian oligarchs or Arabian sheikhs. They have these huge boats. And don't think that they have them for pleasure. Let's look at the Eclipse. That's Roman Abramovich's yacht. It used to be the largest privately owned vessel in the world, 160 meters long, until some sheikh built a larger one a couple of years ago. But this boat has on board a wholly functional intensive care unit, including doctors and nurses, a small 20-man army of very well-trained mercenaries. It has two helipads, it has anti-aircraft missiles, and this is sort of the distinction thing of the billionaires these days, it has a small submarine. So in case this swimming fortress gets taken, Abramovich can still go into his little submarine and bug out again. We, coming from Germany, were of course wondering what our government does to prepare for a situation like that. And interestingly enough, the only thing we found was that up until the 80s, both German governments had nuclear shelters. One right outside Berlin, one in the Eifel Mountains close to Bonn, one for each government. But after 89 and unification happened, both of these were sold and they're now privately owned museums. So we don't really know which strategy Angela Merkel will be following.
This happens as well on the level of nations or states. Europe, for example, prepares for a complete shutdown. They are rehearsing already now to know what to do when the masses try to come in. I'm sure you are all aware of this. In case you are neither a super rich person nor a worldwide important politician or a nationality, you might do it like the brokers do. Among brokers, 35 is kind of the magic border. When you reach the age of 35, you should have put enough money aside so that afterwards you can live completely detached from societies or any outside help. Are you rich? Are you super rich, a politician or a state? I fear not. Then at least, I hope, you have a pension plan, you do some sports twice or three times a week, and you buy food in a health food store. Because all that is preparation for the catastrophe without events. It would be easy to make some jokes about this now, but I suggest we take that serious. Each and everyone individually should prepare the fortress that he and she is and make it safe, being able to defend yourself and the small things you got aside from the lumpenproletariat and the other unprepared fuckers that are out there in the street trying to get what you have.
So you see that everybody's preparing, but most of them are not doing it very well. But there's a group of people who are not super rich, or nations, and they're doing it very, very well. They're called the preppers, from prepare. It's a mostly American movement, but it's spreading here as well. And these are people who think a very specific catastrophe is going to hit them, sometime quite soon, and they're doing everything in their power to survive that catastrophe. So what do the preppers do? Most of all, they do storage. They have huge amount of food in their basement. They have water, thousands of liters of water. They have clothes, they have weapons and ammunition. They have all kinds of gear, medical equipment, and things to barter with. So even if you don't smoke, or don't drink, it would be good to have a few bottles of liquor and some cigarettes because they will be in very high demand and you can ask high prices for them after the catastrophes. They also learn all kinds of skills. For example, things our grandmothers used to do, making jam and preserves, putting the veggies and the fruit into glasses and having those in the basement. Of course, preferably grown in your own garden because that garden would still be there when the supermarket is not. You could also learn first aid, learn to shoot, you could learn all kinds of handiwork, skills, orientation without electronics, and you could try to keep fit. But most important for the preppers is the space. That's the decision I mentioned before. Either you bug out, then you have your car ready, always a tank full of gas, the most important things in it, you have your bug out bag with your papers, some food, some clothes, everything you need for the initial 3 days, and you have a place to go to, and the route to get there really planned out. And in that place, you then have your food source. Preferably very, very far away from where other people live. And if you're already out in the country, you might choose the dig-in strategy. Digging in means you have a nuclear shelter under your house, and you have all your preparations in there. And so in the event when the shit hits the fan, as the preppers say, as it did tonight, you just go down there, you close the hatch, you can live there happily ever after, or at least for 2 or 3 months. And after that, you open your hatch, come out again, and you see how things are going.
So if we look at those guys, we have to imagine perfectly prepared people, trained military style, knowing what to do in whatever situation. Now the weird thing is, they are doing all that, at the same time they are scared shitless. Here the preparation, knowing how to react to almost whatever situation hits them, and for one specific one they are completely prepared, nothing can happen to them, but at the same time completely scared. We are asking, where does this fear come from?
And you shall know in a few seconds, because we said tonight it has happened. So let's find out what has happened. This is the wheel of misfortune. one in my metal canteen and one in my foldable written pouch in my backpack. I have water purification tablets and a small portable filtration system. I have three lighters.
I have a mirror. Several rolls of toilet paper. I have a variety of waterproof plastic containers of different sizes. I have a very commonly looking multi-tool with 17 functions.
I have a tent. I have three lighters. I have gold. I have silver, 500 euros in cash. I have a drinking bottle. I have a tent. I have batteries. And I have a gun.
LED headlamp. I have four handheld torches of different sizes. One very small one on my key ring. I have batteries and rechargeable batteries, all needed sizes. I have three candles and matches. And I have a Swiss Army knife with a USB stick.
I have two 100-liter garbage bags. I have five resealable plastic bags of different sizes. I have a spork. I have a camping stove. And I have eight tablets of fuel that I can use. I have a metal pot. I have a metal cup. I have a pot scrubber. I have three lighters.
since the 19th century.
Tim uses part of the top during firearm practice.
Cool socks.
Jason demonstrates urban survival skills.
I have a medium weight. Please, Jack.
If you buy it now,
Jules prepares for the collapse.
For only €100, you can get enough beans and rice to feed a family of four for 1 month.
That plans ahead to survive hyperinflation.
I have a knife.
An aggressive virus that hits
an
urban environment with 3.5 million humans living there would kill 4 days after its first appearance 80% of the humans. All the ice on Greenland melts, the worldwide sea levels would rise by 7 meters. If all the ice of the Antarctic melts, the worldwide sea levels would raise by 65 meters.
Larry turns an underground missile.
More than 10% of humanity live less than 10 meters above sea level.
I have 6,000 liters of water.
Becky makes sure she and the others are ready for Marshall Fall.
It is proved that the computer virus Stuxnet can be used to open
over
the electronic doors in U.S. prisons. The U.S. government has the largest storage of raw oil. Without further importing oil, those storage would be empty after 38 days.
Underground structures.
~100 grams of locust contain eiweiß, vitamins, and a tiny bit of sugar.
Months ago, the earth erupted in a fireball. Birds fell from the sky. People died. A heat wave rushed over all continents, and huge amount of dust blew up into the sky. And there they sit now. All of Earth is covered by one humongous cloud of dust. And the sun cannot shine down on our Earth anymore. Your telephones don't work. You cannot ask Google what to do next. Your fridge does not cool anything anymore. It is empty. The automatic teller machine will not give you any money. There is nothing at all to buy all of a sudden. Are you still laughing at those who warned you about the nuclear winter? When the nuclear winter comes knocking on my door, I will open a tiny latch and I will say, nuclear winter, I am not scared of you. I am ready. I got my beans in my basement. I have my generator and diesel for 1 year. I have gauze bandages. I have chloride tablets. And I have fat for 1 year. Nuclear winter, you don't scare me. I am prepared. And when that all of you come knocking at my door, I will look out of my little hatch and I will say to you, look, I told you so before. And then you say, give us of your beans, we are hungry. Give us, the telephone doesn't work anymore. Give us, the supermarket is closed. Give us, we are offline. And then I will say to you, I told you so. There's not enough to go around. And that, I will close the little hatch. I walk down the stairs to my basement. I will sit there and I shall eat beans.
Thank you.
Benner.
The dog is there.
Benner.
My woman is there.
Benner.
Her sister is there.
Benner. Benner.
Is there.
Benner.
The children.
Benner. Benner.
The man.
Benner.
Is there.
Benner.
The shopkeeper.
Benner. Benner.
Where is that?
Benner. Benner.
The cow is
there. Benner.
The doctor.
Benner. Benner.
The mailman.
Benner.
The
Benner.
Is there.
Benner.
All his cow.
Benner.
We all know this is usually the end. A bunch of people have survived the catastrophe and they're going to start over again somehow. Of course, in these movies, it's always the white heterosexual people from the US who survive. So we can pretty much imagine how the new world is going to look like.
The new society is pretty much going to look like the old one.
Those people, the Prepts, don't only survive the first hour. In the first hour, they take their bug-out bags, jump into their bug-out vehicles, and drive out of the cities on the carefully pre-planned and rehearsed route to the bunker in the middle of the woods. And there, they are going to survive the first 3 to 4 weeks, which is the crucial time after which at least half of humanity will be gone. Now, how life there is going to look, we know as well. Those guys are going there by themselves, maximum their wife, 2 children, and a dog. If they have a couple of friends around them, they're gonna be in some sort of clan. So it's all patriarchal family structures they are going to live in, or extremely hierarchical clan structures, with one boss telling the others what to do, everybody on the arms, knowing how to deal with them. The men, warrior farmers, the women in the kitchen cooking marmalade or being in bed giving birth. No individualism. People fighting about their personal property and defending it. And extreme exclusion towards the others who are not part of the family or the clan. Do we want to live like that? Society is a weapon.
We don't want to live like that. And we are wondering, all these experiments, all these ideals we've had for the last 20, 30 years, for a world of equals, where everybody has their say, it's non-exclusive, non-hierarchical. Are these ideas helpful at all when we now start building the new society, organize the forms of we live together? Actually, there are groups who have sort of given up their individuality and they renounce Western capitalism, and they seem to function quite well in times of crisis. Take the Islamic State, for example. People are streaming there from all over the world because there they can live their ideals. They can be in a group that where everybody puts their own interests under behind the greater good, where they live a life that is devoid of earthly things, and where everybody is there for one another, a big band of brothers. Well, the sisters are hidden away somewhere, I guess. Or if you look at Ukraine, both sides of that conflict, there are all these people who sacrifice their lives for their ideals, Mother Russia or Mother Ukraine. And that's so much more important than they are themselves. It functions well. But there's some problem with this as well, of course. These are extremely exclusive. They really need the other that they want to kill. And the rules they make never apply to the leaders. The leaders are always a little bit more equal than the rest of the gang. So we don't want that either.
Society is a weapon. What we want is openness, is participation, is diversity. These are the structures we are used to, the principles we like to live after. And of course, all that based on a critical opinion about individual property.
But it won't work. And we know why. Because in these ideals, we get it all mixed up. We mix all the individual liberties of the bourgeois revolution, everybody does what they please, with the collective liberties of the communist ideology. We want all of that. And then we want, as icing on the cake, a feeling of spiritual at-homeness. What we want is to have the cake, to be safe, to eat it, be hedonistic, and then we want to share it equally with everybody.
There's only one cave.
Society is a weapon. Imagine that. Us, or maybe some of us, made it out there against all odds. We live in our little collective. We even got some resources, a little bit to eat, some medication. And we're living there, discussing every night, every single decision. That tuna can, how's it gonna be shared? What's next that needs to be done? Maybe build a little hut. It's good so far. But then one day, there comes another little group knocking at our door, saying, hey guys, we ran out of food. Do you have some for us? What are we gonna do? Are we just inviting them in? Which means we have to split those resources. Or how are we going to deal during the first night, for example? Are we sure that they are not going to chop off our heads and just take our little resources and live with them for a couple of days? Another group comes, if we survive that first one. Two people are injured. They're asking, can we have some of your medication? Do we have some bandages? And the same process starts over again. And probably, very quickly, we're going to start to have quite a close look at those people who are standing in front of our doors and ask ourselves, are we gonna let those guys in or not? Society is a weapon.
Or to put it in a different way, how evil do the good guys have to become in order to fight evil? Or to put it yet another way, how evil can we become and still be the good guys? Are these the decisions that humans have to take at the end of humanity? In that case, we decide we do not want to be humans anymore. We quit.
Figure one is the pictorial view. Figure two is an explosion view. Figure three is an elevated view. Figure four is an enlarged fragmentary view. Figure five is an enlarged fragmentary view. Is a section view. Figures 7a to 7d are enlarged fragmentary views, illustrating several aspects. Figure 8 is an enlarged pictorial view. Figure 9 is an enlarged elevation view showing details. Figure 10 is a plan view of the follower in the disclosed embodiment. Is a top view of the follower shown in figure 10. Figure 12 is an end elevation view of the follower. I claim a drum magazine for loading and feeding. adding rounds of ammunition to a firearm. Extension means extending from sand body. Follower means carried by sand rotor. Follower means immovably inward. Feed means cooperating with sand rotor. Stationary means located for engagement. Follower means being movable. Follower means being displaceable. Drum body means open at least at one end. I claim a drum magazine comprising a body, a rotor, a plurality of discrete ground receiving locations. Extension means extending from said rotor. Follower means carried by said body. Follower means being movable inwardly. Feed means cooperating with said rotor. Follower means being movable. Follower means being displaceable. Follower means being carried. Follower means including a follower member. I claim a drum magazine comprising a body, a rotor, a plurality of discrete ground receiving locations.
we are to survive. We have to enter into exchanges with all people, animals, plants, ideas, knowledge, the weather, the air, and the earth.
Not decide not to think.
The AA-12 is our catalyst. What is special about her is her unlimited ability to take in and dispense material.
Her heart is the magazine, a body with 25 calluses. Recesses, body orifices, and a rotor.
The AA-12
shoots 120 small shot charges per minute.
The AA-12
has no recoil,
no shaking and hitting, no movement in the opposite direction.
She takes all knowledge, all viruses and genes into her body and dispenses them out of one of her orifices.
Our society is a fully automatic weapon, a deadly machine. New pellets of truth permanently erupt out of her openings.
The magazine is her heart. It loads everything and hurdles it out. She reaches and opens all other bodies around her.
One body accepts the fragments into its flesh. They become part of that body.
Others stand in the storm of fragments. They dissolve, only to be fired again.
Ah, half fluid,
half solid.
Subject to rapid transformations. Everything is a target.
Everything is ammunition.
We'll see you later.